Good morning.
Good morning.
It is good to see everyone here today. Thank you for coming. Thank you for being here. I hope as we gather together that God's Holy Spirit can be felt in us and through us and among us, that we find a blessing in the hour that we have together. I'm kind of like Jack. It's already been a blessing just to see each one and to be a part, to be together. What an extraordinary blessing it is. We want to welcome everyone who can see us today or hear us. We want you to know that our hearts are open to you. Our hearts are open that God would touch your lives. And so we pray for you as we gather here and as we worship. We're also praying that the Spirit of God is worshiping with you and inside of you as we are together. Thank you for joining with us. I want to thank WRMG for the broadcast, for YouTube, Facebook. I can't remember all the and TV. So we are fortunate. We are so fortunate to have that opportunity. And again, we pray that because we do have the good fortune and opportunity to do that it reaches into people's lives that are out there. So it is so good to be here, and we pray you'll find a blessing in it.
Thank you, Brother Steve. We're going to get into our worship and song this morning. Our first hymn this morning is hymn number 170. We're going to be singing out of the celebration hymnal this morning. And our first hymn is hymn number 170. Let's all stand as we give thanks this morning. 170. I want to ask you to remain standing for our affirmation of faith this morning. It's in your bulletin.
Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. We believe in God the Father Almighty, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives. whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love, as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen.
You may be seated. Our next hymn this morning is hymn number 692, God Will Take Care of You. 692. This time for ushers will come and receive this morning's regular offering, and that'll be followed by our building fund offering.
Thank you.
Our final hymn before we turn it over to Brother Steve for this morning is Since Jesus Came Into My Heart, 503. At this time, we'll turn it over to Brother Steve for this morning's message.
Thank you, sir.
You may can tell from my voice, I don't know, that a little bit under the weather this morning. But I want you to know that before it was good daylight, I did test myself for COVID. And I know that I do not have COVID, so you don't, at least you don't have to worry about that. I think it's just the time of year that it is, but... This morning, if you have your Bibles with you and like to join with me in reading, we'll be reading from Luke chapter 17, verses 11 through 19. Luke 17, verses 11 through 19. Now it happened as he went to Jerusalem that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. Then as he entered a certain village, there met him 10 men who were lepers, who stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. So when he saw them, he said to them, Go show yourselves to the priest. And so it was that they went, and they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, returned and with a loud voice glorified God, and fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. So Jesus answered and said, Were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? Were there not any found who returned to give glory to God except this foreigner? He said to him, Arise, go your way. Your faith has made you well. May the Lord bless the reading and the hearing of his words. One night, many years ago, Ed Spencer, a student at a seminary right next to Lake Michigan in Chicago, was awakened by shouts. There had been a shipwreck offshore, right in front of the campus. An excursion boat had run into from the Chicago Harbor, had collided with a freighter, and it was sinking. Spencer ran down to the lake shore from which he could see the lights of both the boats. A strong swimmer, he plunged into the icy waters, and he began to start looking for survivors. For 6 hours, Spencer swam out and back, bringing people ashore, battling the stormy waves and the strong undertow. By dawn, he had personally rescued 15 people in his many trips. Exhausted, he sat down on the bank, and someone spotted that there were still two more out in the water. Spencer dove in again, and he found a man and a woman clinging to a piece of wreckage. He brought them in too. But this time, as he came in, he collapsed on the beach. Fewer than 1/4 of the 400 passengers on that ship survived the wreck. 17 of them were rescued by Ed Spencer. His own health, however, was irreparably damaged by his acts of heroism. And he was never able to return to school, ultimately living out his days confined to a wheelchair. Years later, a reporter doing a story on Great Lakes tragedies found Spencer. He found Spencer as an old man in a nursing home in California and asked him his recollections of that night. Spencer, he said, with his head low, "The only thing that I really remember is that not one of the 17 ever thanked me for rescuing them." Ingratitude for some people is a way of life, a very ugly way of life. Everyone who lives a life dedicated to others encounters it at some time or another in their work. John Feinstein writes this story. Golfing legend Arnold Palmer encounters professional golfers on a regular basis who do not appreciate the good fortune or the good situation that they have. He says that players complain to me all the time about how hard it is to constantly sign autographs, to talk to the press, to spend time with amateurs, he said. But when they do, I tell them all the same thing. If you don't like it, don't walk out of the clubhouse door. Quit. No one is forcing you to do this. He sighed and said, "A lot of players just don't understand how lucky we are all. We all are being able to do what we want to do. I look at my life and I can only be thankful," Palmer says, "for everything I've been given by so many people over so many years." Feinstein adds this comment, maybe that is the key to Arnold Daniel Palmer. After all these years, after playing golf with 6 different presidents, after having signed every autograph and granting every interview request, after making many golfers wealthy men, he looks back and talks not about what he did for golf, but instead what golf did for him. Sometimes people forget how blessed we are. Have you ever wondered what it would be like to have been born in, say, Iran rather than in the United States? Have you ever wondered what it would be like if tomorrow you were no longer certain there would be food for your table? Have you ever wondered what it would be like to see your children leave this world because they lived in a life of malnourishment? I wonder what it would be like if no one ever loved me. I wonder what it would be like to have never played ball or to seen a football game or to celebrate Christmas or Easter. I wonder what my life would have been like without Angie or Ben or all of you. What would it have been like to worry every minute, every day, not whether or not I could make the house payment, but whether or not my child might be called off to war somewhere. I wonder what it is like to see your home bombed, your friends and neighbors destroyed in violent acts, both domestic and foreign. What would it be like without my community, my friends, my family, my health to provide for myself and those I love? There may be one of those questions that will have to be answered someday. Life is life, and life has no concept of fair. It deals hard blows in its own time. But as I live and breathe right now, like you, I know what it is like to feel safe and loved and provided for. I know what it means not to be consumed by worry. I know what it is like to enjoy one blessing after another, just as you do. Life is not a match for all the blessings that I've received. I look at you and you look at me, and we all know the truth, don't we? We've all been blessed in more ways than any of us deserve. God has been good to us because God is always good to us. We live blessed lives, each of us, all of us. There are, however, moments that we cannot see them because something else has invaded our life, our mind, and space. Sometimes the events in this life become consuming, demanding all of our attention. We're just trying to get from here to there because at the moment that's the best we can do. But I think God understands that. And so he provides just a little more touch of his Holy Spirit to shepherd us through those times. He speaks to our hearts and he tells us, I'm still here and I can and will hear you when you have a moment to talk to me. Those times come too. And because we believe in God and Christ, we know that as we speak from our hearts, no matter the need or the urgency, the God we believe in hears us. Not only does he hear us, but he feels our struggles and he knows our needs. We are all blessed, aren't we? With a Lord who is here for us, with a God who has provided for us, who ministers to us, who saves us and even redeems us when we fail. All of that deserves a word of thanks, don't you think? In fact, it deserves more than a word of thanks. It deserves a life of thanks. You are here, so I must believe that you already know that. Worship is a time. It's a wonderful time to give thanks, to praise God for being God. For being that divine and holy presence that in his way gives us every blessing we've ever enjoyed. We have no reason not to feel gratitude. Gratitude proportionate to the grace that God has shown us throughout our lives. But that isn't our culture, is it? That isn't the world we live in. Maybe there is some comfort in knowing that it's obviously always been like this. Jesus was traveling to Jerusalem, but as he journeyed, he met 10 lepers. All of them who no longer were permitted to mingle with others in their community, not even their own family. Richard Hassler offers some insight into what their lives were like. People in Jesus' time were threatened by leprosy, he writes. Even more than we are today by the advent of AIDS. Definite regulations had been set up by the Jewish community to protect themselves from coming in contact with lepers. For example, in Leviticus chapter 13, the person who has the leprous disease shall wear torn clothing and let the hair of his head be disheveled, and he shall cover his upper lip and cry out, unclean, unclean. He shall remain unclean as long as he has a disease. He is unclean. He shall live alone. His dwelling shall be outside the camp. When a band of lepers meet other people while walking, they must call out that they are lepers. And some ancient authorities even said that in the first century that they must maintain at least 50 yards of distance to separate themselves from all the other ordinary people. Hardly a blessed way to live your life, wouldn't you say? Lepers were not given much hope in biblical times. But Jesus saw them, and he healed them. And he sent them off to be seen, so that they might be let back into their community. I can hardly imagine what that must have been like to suddenly be healed, but not just physically, mind you. But think about the renewal of all of those relationships. Wives and children, not just able to see their dad anymore, but able to embrace him, to kiss him. Just imagine the joy they must have that have overtaken them all as loved ones could be together again. What an immense blessing to have God do this for them. Who could have kept from finding Jesus and falling at his feet in thanksgiving for the new life each of them had been given? Well, it looks like 9 of the 10 could not find the place or the time to thank Christ. And the one that did, he was an outsider to the Jews, a Samaritan. Seems that a real lack of gratitude for what God had done for them. I cannot imagine what kept them from coming back. Apparently, Jesus had not traveled too far away, for there was at least one able to find him. So why not any of the others? Why were they not there giving thanks and praising God and Christ for all that he had done in their lives? Well, I suppose I shouldn't pass judgment on them. Maybe I would have been so caught up in the moment myself and forgot to thank Jesus. But you know what's really interesting in this passage? Jesus notices. He actually notices. Wow. I healed 10, but only one said thank you. I guess it really doesn't matter what I think or even you think of the 9, but I do think it matters what Jesus thinks. Jesus, by the power of God, healed those people. He made them whole and new and gave them a new life. Just like he does for us when we say we believe in him, when we make our professions of faith. He healed them, but words and lives filled with gratitude did not follow. I wonder how that feels. To give something to someone they were begging for a minute ago, and then once you give it to them, hardly a peep from the blessed. I guess it seems to God that acts of mercy and kindness don't actually always translate. They don't always translate into lives filled with thanksgiving and gratitude. Sometimes people just go about their new business as though they managed it all by themselves, taking in the blessings that God has given them without regard to the one who gave it to them. Surely that is disappointing. To the one who gave as much as his own life to help others. That was the world then. I suppose it is the world for many today. Too many. God has been good. He's given us good health and well-being. He has blessed us, enabled them to meet their needs. And yet, not a peep of thanksgiving. Not a moment of worship or reverence. They just go about life as though they shaped it themselves. Is that where we are today? In our world, our country, even our communities. So busy doing our thing that we can't thank God for all the things that he's done for us. I think it is. And I think there's little chance that it's going to change. That is until the day comes when nothing in their lives is assured. And all of us find ourselves in a place where the only real hope that we will ever have is in the hand and the power of God in and around us to help us get through it. But that doesn't mean the world can have its way and that we should just let it have its way. Or that the world can continue to lure the weak and the spiritually afflicted into a false sense of security. And we may not be able to change their minds. We may not be able to awaken them to the truth. Success has always had a way of dulling the senses and quenching the flames of gratitude. But we can do this. We can live our lives. We can live our lives as a praise to Christ. We can walk our walk and talk our talk and testify in any place and every place that we can that God has been good to us. That every moment of our lives is a moment of praise offered to the one who has blessed us with the freedoms we love, the friends that we have, and the neighbors that care and love for us. We can speak and testify to God's faithfulness until they see in us the power of God's touch is actually real and meaningful. And long for it themselves. I am afraid I have come to believe that the days of talking someone and to believing in God and the blessings that God brings into our lives are words today that more often than not fall on deaf ears. But if they see it in us, if they see in us alive in thanksgiving, filled with thanksgiving for what God has done, then maybe they will want it for themselves. If they see in us our lives and testimony, a deep and abiding sense of gratitude that gives us the means to navigate life, no matter what life brings our way, then maybe someday they will hunger for it as well. So yes, we need to live our lives like we are that one that returned to say thank you. Until finally the nine realize that our blessings flow from God and from only God. Until they realize they should return to the place they met the God who would love them and heal them again. Until they realize they never said thank you to the one who redeems them, to the one who provides all their blessings. The good news is this. It is never too late to start. Truth is, Jesus will notice them and us if we do it. But Jesus will also notice if we don't. Our closing hymn. Our closing hymn is page 786. We'll turn to 786. We're going to sing all the verses.
Let's all stand.
Discouraged, thinking all is lost. Count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has.